Good morning students, this is Shweta ma'am and in this session we will conclude the poem The Lake Isle of Innisfree by William Butler Yeats. But students, before concluding and before finishing off the third stanza, third and last stanza of the poem, I would like you to recall the other things, the other stanzas of the poem, that what we just went through and what was there that the poet has said, that the poet has talked about. Actually, the whole poem revolves around the central figure, who is the poet himself. And what is the problem? Actually, the poet is waiting for the peace to come in his life. He is actually at home. He is at home somewhere, but he is longing for another home. The real home means a home that is away from his present home. And for that, he wants to go to the place where he had spent his childhood days, where he was leading that carefree life. He was away from all the worries, all the sorrows. He was never being gloomy when he was a child. So, in that first stanza, in the first stanza of this poem, what he had said, that he is quite determined to just leave the place where he is living presently and go to the Innisfree, go to that island, where he will just spend the rest of his days. And now, what else he wanted to do there? Yes, students. Actually, he wanted to build a small room for himself. Why small room? Because he wanted to live there alone. He had so many people in his life earlier, but they were for no good. All he wants in his life is peace, that loneliness. And why loneliness? That loneliness won't bring sorrow, but joy, that mental peace. See, being a person, whenever we feel distressed or in case we are disturbed enough, what do we ask for the other person with whom we are living in? Don't we ask for some space that should be given to us so that we could revitalize ourselves, so that we could bring that joy in our lives, we can energize ourselves once again and then again mingling with those people, again coming to those worldly affairs, again coming to those materialistic life. So this is what the poet wants. So he wanted that small cabin to be built, 9 rows of beans, honey for himself to feed himself, and then what would he enjoy in his leisure time? For entertainment, he want to have that birds singing all around, the buzzing of bees should be there. And then in the other stanzas, moving on in the poem, he had talked about that he is going to enjoy all the color of Mother Nature, the color that he will experience in the morning, at daytime, and at night. In the evening also, he will be witnessing the returning of the bird lineage to its home, so that the whole sky will be covered with the feathers, the wings, colorful wings, means the colors. Colors are joy. They will bring joy to him. They will bring mental peace to him. They will just provide him that space that he is longing for. He is just waiting for. So, coming to the third stanza, this is what he wants. Again, he is saying, I will sign the poem and you will do it after me. I will arise and go now, for always night and day. I hear the lake lapping with low sounds by the shore. Why do I stand on the roadways or on the pavement's grey? I hear it in the deep heart's core. See how beautifully he has said that what he is going to get, what he will have once he will settle down in Innisfree, the place he is so desperate to go, the place he is so eager to live, the place where he wants to live, where he wants to reside for the remaining years of his life. In the remaining years, he will be there only. And that is why this is what he is saying. I will arise and go now for always night and day. In the rest part of his life, he will stay in Innisfree. And there, it seems that he is taking the resolution. Now students, you can recall yourself that in the first stanza, this was the first phrase. I will arise and go now. And here in the third stanza also, the poet has again repeated. I have to move from this place and I have to go and search for peace. So, and he is hearing in that process now, while determining, by just recalling all those incidences that he had gone through in his childhood days, he is saying, I even hear the lake water lapping with low sound. Now, what do you mean by lapping? See, students, lapping actually means striking. Now, the striking of the lake sound, and there he has written low. Low sound, why low sound? Because it won't be harsh enough, it won't be shrill. That is not going to give him any kind of disturbance. That is going to give peace to his ear. He will love it. Means for peace, everything will be low, will be very much confined. So, by the shore, he can just imagine as if he is sitting by the shore and the lake water is striking and he is feeling quite happy. While I stand on the roadways, now again he is imagining, he is somewhere else and he is imagining, he is just recalling all those days that are yet to come. Now once I go there, now I will enjoy the sound, that soft sound, that soft striking sound of the lake water. And he is standing on the roadways. Roadways is that part of the road confined for vehicles. So he is standing, suppose he is standing on the middle of the road, and though physically he is present there, mentally, spiritually he has just gone already in his brain and he wants his body to go there for the rest part of his life. And on the pavements there, see, pavements is basically the area that is for pedestrians, the man, the people who walk on foot from the place, and it has been said grey. Now why grey? Actually, the color grey shows mourning, that sadness, that gloomy nature of the pavements, because there is nothing interesting left in that place where he is living. And obviously, no one wants his or her life to be monotonous. Everyone wants it to be quite joyful, quite interesting. Means every time something new will come to them that will give them peace, that will soothe in their mind, their body, and they will just live there peacefully. So there, the present, in his present state, the area, the place where he is residing, is actually has become gloomy. Everywhere he can find sadness, and that is why he hears it in the deep heart's core. And just because of that sadness, just because of that gloominess of the roadways and the pavements, he won't to go there. And in his, he is saying that I hear it in the deep heart's core. So what is he hearing? He is hearing the striking sound of the lake water, that lapping sound, lapping with the lake water, lapping with low sounds by the shore. And he is feeling quite, he is just rejuvenating himself. He is just quite happy. He can have that, he can just be quite happy in that place. So students, this is what he wants. So what would be the central idea of the poem? Actually, central idea of the poem is just mingling with nature, the mother nature, where you are not going to have anything that will depress you, that will suppress you, that will make you feel sorry for anything, or that will make you feel that you are nobody. You will get a new life there. You will, and a life that is full of colors, full of all colors, that are there to provide you happiness only. You will be quite glad, gleefully you are going to spend the rest of your life. So actually, search of peace, search of tranquility, that to just get away over his loneliness. Means he is surrounded by so many people, but those people are doing nothing for him that will give him peace, that will give him anything that he will cherish in his future. Now, coming to the literary devices of these four lines, first of all, talking about the rhyming scheme, it's the same like the other two standards, that is A, B and A, B. They is rhyming with grey, and then shore is rhyming with core, that heart's core, means in the bottom of his heart, he can hear that striking the second line. Here it is. Lake, lapping, low. That L sound is there. Flake, lapping, low. In the same line, the consonant sound has been repeated into two, three words. So this has been, and this is the example of alliteration in this tanja. Apart from this, you have one more literary device, that is onomatopoeia. Now it's quite simple. Onomatopoeia is a figure of speech that talks about sound words. Okay, the word that creates sounds that make you feel. As soon as you hear that word, you can imagine the sound. That is lapping. Now here we have the second line only of the third sentence. Lapping. That means striking sound. There are other example of also very common example like buzzing of bees. We have talked about the hummingbird. The ringing of bells, these are the examples of onomatopoeia, means simply the words that are creating sounds. One more thing that you have to keep in your mind, that repetition is also here